Hello, everybody in Peru. This is from Brussels and from Italy. A presentation for the consortium of the short course. I hope you are enjoying the course so far. My name is Anne Calvert. I'm an infection preventionist. And my colleague at the other side in Italy for the moment, Ernestina, maybe you can say hi just to see if the video works, the sound is working.
Hi, everybody. I'm Ernestina. I'm a colleague of Anne, and I'm an infectious disease doctor.
Fantastic.
Nice to be with you.
Great. Everything is working. So together, we are quite complementary. We try to prevent infectious diseases, and when they are not prevented, Ernestina definitely tries to treat them. So voilà. Today's, one more important thing. We will record this video from beginning till the end with no stops. So if you hear some or crazy silences, it's part of the game. Just bear with us. We do this in one track, all right? So today, this 50 minutes class is about hospital committees, and more specifically for infection prevention and control and antibiotic stewardship. To be sure that we are all on the same page to start with, we will firstly define what this means, IPC, infection prevention and control, and Ernestina will explain what we mean with antibiotic stewardship. So infection prevention and control, it's a practical, evidence-based approach preventing patients and healthcare workers from being harmed by avoidable infections. So effective IPC requires constant actions at all levels of the health system, going from policymakers to facility managers, health workers, all the way to those who access the health services. It's unique in the field of patient safety and quality of care, as it is universally relevant to every healthcare worker and patient at every healthcare interaction. And the effective IPC causes harm and can kill. So without effective IPC, it's impossible to achieve quality healthcare. Ernestina?
When we talk about antibiotic stewardship, I find that one of the most comprehensive definition comes from the Infectious Disease Society of America, so that antibiotic stewardship can be defined as a set of coordinated interventions that are designed to measure and improve how antibiotics are prescribed by clinicians, including the choice, the dose, the duration, and the route, and how they are used by patients.
Thank you.
Next one.
So that's clear so far. We have a few objectives for you for the coming 50 minutes. We would really like that by the end of this session, you will be able to, first of all, know your own country or regional, if that's relevant, regulations and recommendations regarding IPC and ABS committees in the hospital. I just hear a sound, so I'm wondering what's this, but it's okay. Another objective is describe the international recommendations practices regarding the IPC and ABS structures in hospitals. Understand the difference between a team and a committee. Argue advantages or strong points and disadvantages or constraints of committees, and gain insight in how to increase the potentials of the committees, how to deal with disadvantages and uplift advantages, basically. So these are the objectives for this session. The first one, the regulations or guidelines in Peru. I'm not familiar with your context, but I did a little research. The point is that you guys find out how are the regulations or recommendations in terms of committees in your hospital, and more specifically on infection prevention and control and antibiotic stewardship. So as I said, I did a little research for IPC and I find some norma. If I'm not wrong, They're from 2004, which is not the youngest anymore. And norma means it really should be done in the institution. I found also some lineamientos. They are more recent, but they're also like giving ideas on how to do it. So it's not, as far as I understood, not obligatory. But please, guys, I invite you, go and have a look online and find out what is the structure recommended for IPC and ABS, because ABS, we did not find antibiotic stewardship, we did not find so much for Peru. So I hope you are more lucky and find a bit more on regulations and guidelines for your country. So that brings us straight away to the second objective, which is describe the international recommendations and practices regarding the IPC and IPC ABS structures in the hospital. And we will also really try to make clear what is the difference between a team and a committee, because as far as we could investigate for Peru, the concept of team, at least like officially mandated team, be it for IPC or ABS, is not yet a very well-known term. So that's why it's important we want to explain what is a team and what is a committee. We will do this, the international recommendations, we will do it for IPC and ABS. I will start, first of all, with the IPC part. The main source for this information is coming from the WHO, and they have written a guideline a few years ago, if I'm not wrong, it's 2016, on core components of IPC programs at national and acute healthcare facility level. It is translated in Spanish, so that's why I put here the Spanish picture on the slide. So please, it's open access online, so have a look at it. What is it? Basically, it's 8 core components. So what is really, what are the things you need to do proper IPC? And they have framed 8 at facility level and 6 at national level. For this course, obviously, we focus on the facility level. The first core component is an IPC program. I will go more in depth to this because later on, because this is the core of the course, eh? Of this class. The second core component is that you need to have evidence-based guidelines. Third one, you need education and training regarding IPC. Fourth one is a very strong point, as far as I understood, for Peru, it is surveillance. 5, multimodal strategies. 6, monitoring, audit, and feedback. 7, workload, staffing, and bed occupancy. And 8 is all about the built environment, materials, and equipment. So the first core component is the one that we need for today. It is infection prevention and control program. And what do they say? They say the panel recommends that an IPC program with a dedicated trained team should be in place in each acute healthcare facility for the purpose of preventing HAI, so healthcare-associated infections, and combating AMR through IPC good practices. So if you notice this well, this class is about committees, but what they mainly recommend is, first of all, to have a team, IPC team, as you can see on this slide, with the Spanish translation, obviously. The WHO also has written, based on these core components, guideline, they have written an interim practical manual supporting implementation of these guidelines. And they also go core component by core component. And so for the IPC programs, I'm going to read for you what they put. The existence of an IPC program with a dedicated IPC lead or focal person and the team with a clear mandate, dedicated budget, and supported by an IPC committee. I think the word supported is very important in this class. Well, all of this is a critical first step that will support the implementation of all core components and will enable the prioritization and implementation of other core components according to the local context, as well as baseline and regular assessments. In that same guideline, they give examples now. They give example of the roles and responsibilities of the IPC team. And as roles, what do they say? They say develop and execute the IPC program. Develop and adapt and disseminate guidelines. Develop and coordinate a program of continuous education and training. Develop and coordinate systems for healthcare-associated infection surveillance. Facilitate access to essential infrastructures, materials, and equipment. And build effective linkages with related programs. Promote, lead, and support the implementation of multimodal strategies to achieve IPC improvement. So this is what they give us an example for the roles of this team. They also give suggestions for the responsibilities. For instance, for the IPC program, they talk about formulate a clear goal for the IPC, prepare plans for the prevention of healthcare-associated infections, conduct monitoring, etc. The same also for the aspects around guidelines, develop or strengthen policy and standards of practice, prepare dissemination plans and the program of support for local implementation, ensure that the system is in place, etc. As well for the training and the education, the monitoring, audit and feedback, for the enabling of the environment, the linkages with other programs and these multimodal strategies. So very active verbs and really develop and do the job, basically. This is what they propose as tasks for a team. Competences you need in a team is, of course, you need to know about infection prevention. You need to have expertise covering medical microbiology, healthcare epidemiology, infectious diseases and nursing procedures. And then they also give an example of the constitutions and roles and responsibilities for the IPC committee. And you see it is a bit different than the team. The committee, you see on the left side, a big list of people. So it's a lot of people. It's not as small as the team, with members like the medical superintendent, the head of the nursing, representatives, heads of specialty departments, of course also the people from the IPC team, but also then the head of quality, head of patient safety, etc. Roles and responsibility, they are expressed a bit at a higher level than the team, in the sense it's more monitoring, supervising, overseeing, for example, oversee the implementation of IPC program and plans. So I invite you to read a bit in that guideline and you will find much more details on how they present what is the team, who is in there, what are their roles and the responsibilities, and then what is the committee. And also Ernestina will emphasize even more with more illustrations on the antibiotic stewardship side. So over to you, Ernestina.
Go to the next slide. First of all, a little reminder on why we need to make all these efforts implementing good antibiotic stewardship. Because evidence has showed how this is done to effectively treat infections, so protect patients from harms caused by unnecessary antibiotic use, and combat, finally, antibiotic resistance. So next one. Now, I would like to take now some minutes to discuss about what you need to run an effective antibiotic stewardship in a hospital. We can say that we have two levels of interventions. You have one level that is the everyday patient's level intervention, and another one that is the structural level intervention. So schematizing for the first level, you will need to build up an antibiotic stewardship team, so your team. And for the second level, you need to put in place an antibiotic stewardship committees. These two entities works at different levels with different roles and responsibilities. And the members of each group can partially overlap sometimes. And if so, their task will be different according to the specific membership that they have in that specific moment. So it depends if in that moment you have the head of a team member or of a committee member. Next one. What I found in literature, in the documents, is the National Action Plan for Antimicrobial Resistance in Peru, 2017-2021, that clearly identifies in its strategic plan, its operational plan, and its follow-up and monitoring plan a key objective. And maybe we go to the next one. And one of the key objective I'm speaking about is the reinforcement and the coordination of IPC and antibiotic stewardship committee. However, in these documents, they don't mention the antibiotic stewardship team. So next one, to show all the different documents that you can also find in internet in extent. Next one. Another source that you can find and free, downloadable and online is this one. So it's a recommendation for implementing antimicrobial stewardship program in Latin America and the Caribbean, developed by Pan American Health Organization in 2018. And this actually, it's highlighted the importance to have antimicrobial stewardship team. Next one. Here you see part number two, the very important paragraph fully dedicated to the antimicrobial stewardship team with the difference between core members and supporting members. But we will speak a little bit more later on. Next one. What is a team? We can define a team as a group of people who work together activity or a project in order to achieve an objective that is a shared objective. So next one. First and most important, you need to choose very well the team to reach your objectives. Excuse me, but this was a little bit related to my Italian. Thank you, Anne. Next one. So establishing a multidisciplinary antibiotic stewardship is important and needs to have full administrative support. The administrative support is really essential to create a robust antibiotic stewardship program. The team's composition is not fixed. It should be adapted to the resources that you have available in your own facility. The leaders, that are both authorities and team members, may have to be creative when building a team and establishing a program, as there might be many barriers to the process and there might be constraints on available resources. Next one. So as I said before, the recommendation by PAO divide the team, possible team membership among core members and supportive members. Among the core members, you have physicians. Ideally, they should be, if you have them, an infectious disease specialist on board. However, this is not mandatory and it greatly depends on the availability in your hospital. Pharmacists are a key role. They are a core member of the team. And if they are trained on antibiotic stewardship, antimicrobials or infectious diseases is better. Microbiologists, ideally, these people should have some training in clinical microbiology. And then generalists, they can also be the leaders of antibiotic stewardship as they are more and more present in patient care and they use frequently antibiotics and they are very much committed to quality improvement. Among supportive members, you have infection prevention specialist, Anne already highlighted a little bit, the interaction between team members and IPC is needed to update infection prevalence statistics and trends in the facility to ensure all the necessary precautions to prevent the spread of multidrug resistant organisms are in. Hospital epidemiologists, if you have them, whenever they are available, they support in data collection and system and analysis. And then nurses, these are the professionals that spend most of their time by their patient and interact with many other clinicians as well. Information technology staff, they are critical to integrating the stewardship protocols into the existing workflow. And then quality improvement staff, as the appropriate use of antimicrobials falls under the quality improvement umbrella as it impacts patient safety. And next one. So some key take-home messages from this document is first, establishing an antibiotic stewardship team is a must. With limited resources, the architects of the team will need to be creative and use readily available hospital resources. And with some degrees of expertise in antimicrobial stewardship and also on-the-job training, that is very much important, it is possible to begin the implementation without having to wait for a full perfect to be available on the ground. Next one. Voila, here you see a little bit in a graphic how the antibiotic stewardship team links with the antibiotic stewardship committee and other hospital committees. So the team, patient level intervention in the downward of the states, with all the different possible multidisciplinary profiles that do the daily job. And then they interact with antibiotic stewardship committee, and we will speak a little bit more in details later. And then with other possible committees, including IPC committees for sure. Next one. Now that we have spoken about membership, we can spend some more time to speak about purpose, responsibilities of the team. Here, there is an interesting resource that is also free, downloadable online. It's a WHO toolkit, antimicrobial stewardship in healthcare facilities in low and middle income countries, that is full of interesting tools and reference. So I invite you to check for it. And the main purpose that they put for the antibiotic stewardship team is to implement the antibiotic stewardship action plan and the daily activities at patient level, as we said. So the team is accountable to the antibiotic stewardship committee. And among some of its responsibilities, there are the work forms, the audits on antibiotic prescription or point prevalence survey on antibiotic prescriptions, the monitoring of the quantity of antibiotic consumption in the facility, the monitoring of antibiotic resistance rate in the facility, and facilitating educational initiatives. So we discussed already before about useful membership. And here this document gives you some more suggestion or tips. It foresees three possible scenarios. Of course, we have many more, but these are the biggest possible scenario that we have, depending on the specific context and healthcare structures you are working with. So option one, I would say, is the ideal one when the resources are fully available and the health structure is big. So you choose, as we said before, more than two healthcare professionals with multidisciplinary profiles, so infectious disease, clinicians, pharmacists, IPC nurse, microbiologists. Option two is when you are in the middle. So you have not so many resources, but you have some, so you can start your team with the couple made by a physician and a nurse or a pharmacist, provided that they have access to expert opinion. And the option number three is when you have very limited resources, you start really from scratch, and maybe your health structure is not so big, or it's a primary healthcare hospital. And you can rely, and your team will be made at the beginning by one person, nurse or a pharmacist that can lead the program, provided this possibility of access to expert opinion. And when we say access, we can consider also telemedicine or other of let's say online access. And then the advised number of meetings that are very important, either weekly or two times a month. Next one. I'm not seeing it yet.
It should be there now. Wait, let me try. Oh, sorry. There you go.
Yes. So this is just a slide to highlight in cloud words what are the actions that a team, an antibiotic stewardship team, does in its daily activity. So speak about implementing, monitoring, facilitating, collaborating is a very important verb, delineating, etc. Next one. Here I put a reference from the literature that I found quite interesting from the team of Pulsini. So when it's a matter to calculate the exact number of resources that you need to have in your antibiotic stewardship team, there is not yet a clear international recognized standard to guide you. So this study actually is summarizing some countries' recommendation on staffing for antibiotic stewardship team in hospitals. And you can notice that in general, the numbers of specific core FTE, are based on the number of beds or acute care beds, with quite some variability of standard between countries. That is also normal. But I think this reference that is also freely downloadable online could be a useful referral if you need to advocate for more resources for your team. And next one. Regardless who and how many resources you want to advocate for from your hospital management to build your team, you might need to build a business case to justify your best. And here I share you a reference I found also online, free downloadable. And of course, major arguments that you can use to justify asking for human resources for your stewardship activities comes always from the literature. So you have to say that stewardship activities are proven to decrease cost related to hospitalization with the decreased length of stay. They decrease expenses due to antibiotic prescriptions. They reduce infection due to multi-drug resistance, etc. So these are all arguments that you can use, that you need to use to convince your management. Next one. And now we spend some more time, then we speak about antibiotic stewardship committee. So we move from patient liver intervention to structural liver intervention. So the stewardship committee is the body that works at the structural level of your hospital. A committee in general can be defined as a small group of people that are chosen to represent a larger organization, make informed decisions on behalf of the organization. And next one. And here is a reminder of the slide I showed before on the links and relations between committees and team. So in the upper part, you see now we highlight the committee side with all the different possible committees that you can find in healthcare facilities and the links. So the collaborative links that they need to have between each other. Next one. Well, so a stewardship committee is fundamental to any stewardship program and provides the strategic direction that guides the manpower, intelligence, and resources for any stewardship activities. So depending on your specific setting and hospital, it may be a standalone group, or it may be a subcommittee or a part of a larger group, such as, for example, the Infection Prevention and Control Committee, or Therapeutic Committee, or the Quality and Safety Committee. If it's a standalone group, it should be integrated in the governance structure of the organization so that it's really clearly accountable. Next one. And to have success, a strategic committee will include representative of key staff groups that are involved in antimicrobial prescribing, and which is representative of the organization. So representatives, a very important aspect. Not to forget that one of the biggest challenge for the committee will be having, involving, engaging the required members to attend, and the time commitment from busy healthcare should not be underestimated, because many of them will not have antibiotic stewardship as their main daily task. Next one. So what an antibiotic stewardship is supposed to do? We go again to the same reference that is very important. The WHO stewardship toolkit recommends some possible responsibilities. For example, providing oversight and coordination of stewardship implementation, being accountable either to the national antibiotic stewardship group, if existing, and to the healthcare leadership, such as hospital direction, liaising with other hospital committees, very important, developing and endorsing the stepwise action plan for antibiotic stewardship, ensuring allocation of human resources, time, and budget to run the stewardship activities, ensuring that the training program is in place, reviewing and endorsing clinical guidelines, facilitating the dissemination of stewardship reports. The membership of the committee can be also variable. The most important thing is to choose motivated people with the most strategical profiles within the. So examples that are possible, for example, hospital management. You need to have someone on board from the hospital management because it will help you to open door. Then infectious disease doctors, if available, or skilled doctors on antibiotic and infection. Pharmacists, nursing representatives is also very key, and strategic microbiologists, infection prevention and control nurses or specialists, patient safety representatives, and service directors, especially from the services where the antibiotic stewardship team need to focus on at very first beginning. Next one. Well, this is the summary slide with the key verb about the responsibilities and of antibiotic stewardship committee. So you see here the verbs are a little bit different from the team. We have monitoring, reviewing, developing, ensuring, overseeing, promoting, etc. Next up. And here, the next two slides, I give you some more examples, concrete examples of possible term of reference of antibiotic stewardship committee. For example, first, define its own functions. So why has the committee been set up? Clarifying responsibilities and activities. So what will the committee do? You need to define and put it on paper. The membership of the committee, so who will be in the committee, which departments or services do these members represent, the role of the members, so who is the chair or the leader, who is the secretary, and which members are responsible for specific function. The quorum, this is also important, how many members needed for the committee meeting to go ahead, especially when you have a let's say a starting committee or a committee that's not very active. You have on the papers maybe 10 people and just two are present every time. So you need to define how many members are really active members are needed. How many members are required for decision making, also very important. And next one. Then more examples, frequency and length of committee meetings. So to decide ahead, how often will meetings be held, how long will they last? Not too long, not too short, not too often, but not too rare as well. The agenda preparation and minute circulation, who is responsible to do it? Because everybody will do it, but then nobody will do it maybe. And when these important documents will be circulated to the members, reporting lines is also very important. Does this committee report to other committees? And what are the links, the structural links between the stewardship committee and other possible hospital committees, drug and therapeutic, infection prevention and control, etc. And then how will the effectiveness of the committee be assessed or measured? This is also important. Regularly, there needs to be a reflection on how the committee is working, if it reaches its objective, yes or no. And then reviewing the terms of reference, because this can also be changed and adapted to the needs that the committee sees over time. Next one. And this is a slide I show just to share some tips on how to run an antibiotic stewardship committee meeting and make a meeting as optimal as possible. So first, we said it already, but the frequency of the meetings is important. So meetings need to be regularly planned ahead, ideally monthly, if not quarterly, and this you will decide into your need. The meeting agenda should be circulated ahead. The meeting date, ideally 1 week before the meeting, is. And the agenda needs to be determined by the chair, the stewardship committee chair or focal point. And then what happened during the meeting needs to be recorded and minutes needs to be shared. The latest, I would say 2 weeks after the meeting has happened, otherwise people will forget what has been discussed and decided. And then this sharing time is also important. It needs to be done by the secretary and needs to be shared by the committee members itself and other relevant hospital committees. So I tell them again, but it's really important to highlight these links and collaboration is in place. So drug and therapeutic committee, IPC committee, patient safety committee, and eventually others as needed. And with this, I give back the ball to Anne.
Okay, well received, the ball. Thank you very much for making it very clear, Ernestina, on how to organize the antibiotic stewardship in the hospital with the team and the committee. So that brings us back to the objectives, because we tackled already half of them. The last part of this presentation, we will go a bit further on the advantages or the strong points and the disadvantages or the constraints of committees, and give some limited suggestions on how we could increase the potential of these committees. Eh? For to start with, I found an article. It's quite old by now, but it's really nice to read. So I invite you to look it up and to try to read this one. It's a narrative and it's very nice. And what this Donald Snook, he said is, in spite of the millions of committees that have been formed over the years, there still exists a certain degree of ambiguity and mystery about this management tool. So he said at one moment in this article, is it an albatross or a catalyst? You know, catalyst for change. A committee, a committee can be an albatross around the organization's neck, or it can be a catalyst in getting things done and creating new ideas. There are legitimate reasons for both using and avoiding committees. Committees can help accomplish difficult tasks, or they can stall recommendations and delay action. Committees can set clear-cut objectives and meet them, or they can become process-oriented and costly exercises. Committees can solve difficult problems, or they can primarily be forums for power demonstrations and the exercise of political strength in the organization. So that is just a very small introduction. A quick overview on what he mentions and also what information we received during previous courses from participants as what are advantages of committees. The first one, well, it definitely helps or can help to create an interdisciplinary discussion forum between different parties involved. It keeps the teamwork decision approach, and there is more involvement of hospital staff, and it become it's a more inclusive process if you make decisions in committees. Also, it's a more organized approach in problem solving. It plays a major role in cementing the continuity of ideas within an organization, especially if your management has a high turnover. The committee is it can create a kind of continuity of the memory and of ideas. Provides continuous educational approach because we should not underestimate how much people learn when they are in these committees, because as Ernestina said, it's usually not the daily job of these people. For instance, be it IPC or be it antibiotic stewardship, as a doctor in the hospital or a head nurse or something, they come to these committees and it's really a platform where they can learn a lot about the topic. It obviously creates awareness on the topic, and if you have supply people on board in the committee, that means immediately you have them already informed and you have a good link with supply. So these are some of advantages of committees, which I think should be really highlighted and memorized. We highlighted also five disadvantages or constraints about the committees. One is to, and of course we try to propose you some solutions on how to deal with it. This is a little joke saying we don't want you to view this committee as being in any way confrontational. And then you see the image. Voilà. So the first constraint is so much to do. And this will be kind of everywhere. When you make your assessment, be it for IPC, be it for antibiotic stewardship, you will be overloaded with priorities, with so many things to do. And then in the committees, you need to make decisions. So where do you start? Our advice, start small, baby steps. And step by step, you can increase, you will improve. By the end, you will fly. So start small and you will get there. The second difficulty with the committees in the hospital is that there are probably already too many committees. Eh? So what is our suggestion there? And I think Ernestina has highlighted this at several times. We need to collaborate between committees. Eh? For instance, find the common ground between the antibiotic stewardship committee and the IPC committee. We both need surveillance, we both need training, we both need data. It's the antibiotic stewardship, okay, they prevent resistant selection and infection prevention, they try to prevent the occurrence of the infection, but there's lots in common. So try to not treat the common subject separately, but do it in one time. Too long or unproductive meetings. Eh? This joke, for instance, who called this meeting? Oh, we thought you did. I think we should discuss issues and assign tasks so it's not a complete waste of time. And then he said, oh, maybe meetings have become a life form capable of calling themselves and thus reproducing via human hosts. Just a little joke, because we are already 45 minutes talking on this video. Should be not too long, right? Anyway, five secrets to a productive meeting, and you can see them here. First of all, make sure you have clear goals for your meeting. Your agenda must be clear. Make minutes and distribute them. Ernestina already explained everything about it. Why this lamp? Make sure that you have the space to come up with bright ideas, that you take, you don't come already with decisions to the committee and they just need to approve or disagree. Make time for some brainstorming in the committee as well. And then time management. If you promise a meeting will last for an hour, make it an hour and don't go every time more than what you proposed in the timing. And celebrate your successes together with the committee. Very important. I've put here also, it's kind of a joke, eh? But meetings can have different purposes. Say you can call a meeting for just brainstorming or for decision making. You need to make this clear at the beginning of your meeting. What are your expectations? Unclear roles and responsibilities. So the joke here, how are you doing on your unspoken objectives? My what? I'm referring to the goals I have in mind and that I've never mentioned. How are those going? I'm totally nailing them. This is a story about four people named everybody, somebody, anybody, and nobody. There was an important job to be done, and everybody was sure that somebody would do it. Anybody would have done it, but nobody did it. Somebody got angry about it because it was everybody's job. Everybody thought anybody could do it, but nobody realized that everybody wouldn't do it. It ended up with everybody blamed somebody when nobody did what anybody could have done. So, lessons learned for this unclear roles and responsibilities is that if the committee knows its limits, and so its roles and responsibilities and what he's allowed to do, it will help the committee members to evaluate its effectiveness. And I think we have given already quite some examples on roles and responsibilities or some proposals that can be used. The last one that we find sometimes in the structure of IPC or ABS is the lack of leadership. What can we do about this leadership course? I don't know. What do you think? Isn't there anyone we could ask? You know, this is kind of a joke on the lack of leadership. WHO, especially them in the IPC group of WHO, really realized that leadership is key in successes. And so they made actually quite of a big program on leadership. This is one of their slides they use. But when you go to this website that I show you here on top, you will find a whole package on training and movies and, I mean, training material that you can use for leadership in IPC. So just go there and you will find what you need. Take home messages, teams and committees, they're two different things. They should both exist. At least teams should exist. This is really key because they are the ones doing the job. But they should have, both of them should have clear roles and responsibilities. Work together within one committee, but also between the committees. And key to success, leadership and perseverance. Don't give up. Just keep going. One day we will get there. I thank you very much. And I think Ernestina there is Ernestina back again, because we are, I'm asking to unmute because she's still on mute. Voila. So thank you very much, guys. We will see you at the next committee meeting. Ernestine, I don't know if you have one last word to say.
Your teams and committees and never give up.
Nice one. A big thank you for the people that helped also with this presentation. And I hope you enjoyed the class and we will see each other next time. Ciao.